Okay, then let's start with the wind inputs. So in this talk I will try to explain what different wind inputs exist and talk about the observed inputs, which is where I'm actually responsible for as a in terms of the ocean and sea ice satellite application facility. So that's why you see the HumanSat logo here and the MyOcean logo. So at KNMI we are processing the satellite scatterometer satellite winds from currently different scatterometers, and I will come back to this. And the amount of number of scatterometers is growing, so it becomes more and more interesting to look at the data, because you get temporal samples that are frequent enough to look at mesoscale developments, essentially. So that's the goal we are working on. Okay. So in terms of surges, I first say a little bit about the wind phenomena that are of interest for surges and show some examples. Then I talk about the wind inputs and surge effects. So the first thing are squall lines. Squall lines are, let's say, lines of convection that occur when meteorological cold fronts come in. And in terms of surge, they will cause a surge wave along a line, essentially, which then propagates into the onto the coast, for instance. They generally look like a single wave, so they are in that sense comparable with a harbor type of wave that you would call a tsunami. But of course, it's much more modest. So, so this is not something that is coming in groups. It's coming as single events, essentially. And what is generating it is a cold front, or organized convection can also cause these type of lines. The surge period can be 30 minutes to 3 hours, up to 70 centimeters. Here's an example. So here you see again, this is in the, well, it's actually not from south to north, that would be easier, but this shows one of these systems coming in, and you see the peak, 40 centimeters, 30 centimeters, 60 centimeters coming in at the coast as a peak in the surge. Also at some other stations you see the peak. This is the squall line. So in terms of the rain radar, our rain radar is situated here and here, so it actually can look into more or less this area. And you see that this line is appearing in this area very clearly. and you also see it in here, for instance, as a pretty strong peak. Fortunately, the peak is coming at a low tide, so then of course they are less dangerous than when they come at high tides. But it's coincidence, so they could also just appear at a high tide. Then we have sharp troughs. So troughs exist in all numerical weather prediction models, but sometimes they can be sharper than they are depicted in the model. And then of course you have to be careful. And this is also causing a sudden surge along a line, so it looks a bit like the squall line, but it may be less sharp. But in other aspects it's similar. So this was a storm which I've also already mentioned this morning, 1 November 2006. And this is a station where some flooding took place in the north of Netherlands, Delfzijl. The water height here is 483 above the sea level, and that's the blue line. And if you look at the forecast, it's this purple line, so you see it's far too low. So the purple line is here 393, so it's 90 centimeters different. And then they also routinely, as the surge comes in, they use a tide station on the ocean at K13, And then use this station to predict the tides in Delfzijl. So then you get these forecasts. But you see they're also much below the tide that finally occurred. So there was no indication of this additional tide. Then this is a complicated plot, which I have to explain the first time at least. These are plots which you find on the KNMI website for spectrometer data. So there if you click on the site for near real-time data, you will find many of those similar plots. So in the background you will see an infrared image showing you the cloud structure. And in blue you will find a model field, less dense than here. And in red you will see the spectrometer data. This was 2006, so at this time we did have the American QuickSCAT scattrometer, and we processed them at KNMI, and here you see our products. And if you look at that's the red arrows, you see yellow dots. Yellow dots are essentially places where our algorithm thinks it's raining. So there you will not have a wind. But you will have the wind in other places. So you see there's still many other places where you get red winds. You see maximum winds here, more than 50 knots. And if you look in this location at the winds in the green field, the green field tends to line up with the red field, which means that the green field is the ECVF forecast of the wind. So the ECVF forecast is predicting the winds as the scattrometer is measuring them. So they are aligned. But you see that the ECVF winds are lower. Here is 55 knots in the scattrometer, and you get 45, I think, in the ECVF. So it really is too low. So ECVF has the direction right, but the wind wrong. If you then look at the blue field is a Heerlan field that we produce at KNMI. So it's a different model, it's a mesoscale model. And you see that it has the trough slightly different than ECVF and also slightly different than QuickSCAT data. You see, if you look at wind speeds, you will find over 50 knots in the blue arrows. So in terms of speed, it's much better than ECVF. But the direction is actually a bit turned with respect to the red arrows, which means that the trough is represented in a different way. This is at 6 o'clock in the evening, where the search at Delfzijl in the harbor occurred 6 o'clock in the morning. So here's still 12 hours to go to anticipate this information and think about what the implications could be for Delfzijl. So I think as a forecaster, you'll get this. You did get this data more or less 3 hours after it was measured on your desk. So you still have 9 hours to figure out what this means for the search. So you have some time. You could even run a small model maybe or whatever. Yes? There's another pass at 4 o'clock in the morning. The pass at 4 o'clock in the morning would arrive on your desk somewhere around 6:30. And the flood is occurring at 6 or 6:30. So these satellite data were clearly too late. This had to do with the timeliness of the QuickSCAT satellite. So there's nothing we can do in Europe about this. We have to convince NOAA that they need timely data, and then this can change. In Europe, we have what's called an EERST service. And in that service, the European scattrometer data over Europe are delivered on your desk within 30 or 40 minutes. So much faster. So then this would actually still be useful, because you still would have an hour or so to anticipate what the effect is. Essentially, in this plot, you see the same as in this plot. So again, ECVF lines up with the scattrometer data, but the winds are lower. And Heerlan has the right strength of winds, but they are turned. Delfzijl is over here. So you can imagine that if the winds blow like this, it will enhance the search here.
Hiram has the wind more like that. So then the search estimate is will be more in Denmark and less in Delfzijl. So it's easy to see what the complications can be. So in this case, it was an indication in the observations that the winds can be high. There's also indications in the model the winds can be high. There's also indications in a model that the wind direction could be different than in ECMWF, or than in Hiram. So, yeah. Time to be careful, I would say. Well, this is what happened finally. 6:14, this picture has been taken. You see that the caves here are underwater. There were no casualties in this case. It's called the horses storm because the horses were actually caught in the flood and had to be saved. But there's further only worse material damage in this case. Yeah, so the unpredicted surge was by more than half a meter, and also the ensemble system did not predict this uncertainty. Also not the multi-model ensemble did not predict this uncertainty, because models were either wrong in direction or in speed, but not in both, apparently. So yes, of course, if you can have observations, it helps you to give a better forecast. Yeah, again, the difference between observations and different models. In this case, models have been run at 22, 11, and 5 kilometers. And you see that in this case, the resolution doesn't help to get a better forecast, but actually destroys the forecast, which can also happen, of course, statistically. Then there's this other case. Again, the blue line is the total water level. It peaks at 275. There is the purple forecast here, which is 258, so it's not too bad. But you see it's coming earlier in the observations than it's coming in the model. And then again, there are some other ways to predict tides, but you see they all stay lower. So in this case, the model is quite reasonable. This is again the famous storm with many different names. And here you see there is a peak in the surge. Again, this peak comes at a time when the tide is going down. So in total water level, the blue line, it doesn't make much difference in this particular case. But you see it's quite a big peak. So also large-scale turbulence convection can give additional oscillations, periods from minutes to an hour. Typically you talk about tens of centimeters in this range. Occurs typically within a day because it generally occurs when the weather is unsettled, so you will get more of these showers over the system, over the water, giving rise to modulations. Well, this is a scatterometer image where you see the modulations in the air as measured by the scatterometer system. So this is in the Norwegian Sea. We sampled this product at 12.5 kilometers. For comparison, you see here, let's first talk about this one. Again, in the background, you see some blue arrows for the model. You see the model has this system quite a bit weaker, also with different winds in it. Here you see very sharp convergences appearing. But you also see these mesoscale structures, yes? You see places where the winds are pointing at each other, so there's convergence. You see white above it, which means there's a cloud band. So it means winds are converging, clouds are forming, and it will be raining or snowing or whatever. But you also see places where winds are actually not converging, not diverging, but are diverging and not converging. Also with a white cloud band on top, that probably means that it has been raining or snowing. and the precipitation falls down. And as the precipitation falls down, the air cools, and the air also falls down. And if the air falls down, it spreads over the ocean, and it gives, of course, divergence. So this is something you could meteorologically understand from physical principles. It's not something you will be used to look at, because in most models you will not see it. But now in the in measurements we will see it, and we will move to mesoscale models where you will also see it, and I will show an example of this. And then also things happen that even, well, that I didn't expect at least, which is, for instance, here, because I talked about downburst of wind when it's raining or snowing, yes? But here you see a downburst of wind, and there's no clouds. So that means that wind just falls out of the air and spreads on the ocean. But of course, this will change the surges and everything. I mean, it will also, it's mesoscale variability that is not, we didn't take care of before, so we have to understand how these things happen. Also here you see a fork in the clouds, so you see again air falling down and air flowing around it, making these cloud boundaries. So very interesting meteorological phenomena occur that we didn't think of before. The left plot is a plot at 50 kilometers, but it's in the tropics. So in the tropics you have convection, and models will not show convection in the way that the scatterometer data show it, even at the scale of 50 kilometers. If you look into the ECF model, you will not see these convective cells. But you can understand that these convective cells completely change the wind field. It makes it dramatically different. So if you want to do surges in the tropics, you will have to look at observations of winds in order to be able to have any idea of what's going to happen. Well, then of course you can again look at the tide gauges, where you see these type of variations that are caused by these convective systems at our latitudes. This is for the Netherlands. And again, yes, you see modulations 24, 20, 20 centimeters, something like this, that is caused by these convective systems. You also have seiches, which is a sudden surge along the coast, which is reinforced in a harbor, so there's a resonance effect in harbors. The cause is, again, atmospheric convective cells above the North Sea, in our case, with associated wind fluctuations of periods of 1 to 2 hours. But in other regions, it can also be caused by long-range swell systems that propagate to a harbor and then cause a resonance in the harbor. And that's also known as a... few hours. And the surge can be quite dramatic because of this resonance effect. Yeah. So here you see one or two examples which show a big amplitude. So now we've been showing you tide gauge data at 10 minutes, but we can also have the data at 1 minute. And the red and blue line are 1 minute data. And this purple line here is the, I'm not sure you can see it very well, but that's the 10 minute data. And for instance, here you see modulations. And also here at the top of, this is 3 meters, 4 meters, so this distance is 25 centimeters. So also on a shorter time scale, you see quite big variations that are relevant. And if you do 10 minute measurements, it means that you can miss, for instance, seiches that have a period of 10 minutes. So you have to be careful there. But there's a lot of small scales in Okay, this is showing the mechanism. Of course, for convection, you need big temperature gradients in the atmosphere. You get convective cells that grow in time. That's associated cloud structure. Typical dimensions of open cells are 30 to 100 kilometer. Typical depth, 2 to 4 kilometers. And of course, the clouds are associated with the cells, but you can also clear that there will be a component at the surface pointing or reinforcing the surge or slowing down the surge depending on the phase of the. And this is how it looks like typically. So you have these open cell structures if the instability is big enough. Okay, so now I said something about things that happen in the atmosphere on mesoscales and about observations that you can use to look at those mesoscales. So now I'm going to talk a bit about what you can get from models and observations in terms of these small-scale structures. So most of you may have seen this graph before because it's quite popular. But let me explain it again. So on the vertical axis you see a measure of accuracy, and on the horizontal axis you see the years from early 80s until 2010. And then if you take, for instance, the upper blue line, it's for a 3-day forecast. You see that the 3-day forecast accuracy is increasing over time until today. You can do the same for 5 days. And you also see the increase. There's two curves actually for each day. One is the upper one, the bold upper one is a northern hemisphere, and the lower one is a southern hemisphere. So you also see that the curves are actually coming together. The reason why the southern hemisphere was less accurate in the past than the northern hemisphere is because we had no observations, or very little observations, in the southern hemisphere. Today, ICMF is estimating something like 60 different satellite instruments. That, of course, makes the observing system much more uniform. And we believe that it's an important reason why the southern hemisphere scale is now very similar to the scale in the northern hemisphere. If you go back from day 5 along a horizontal line, you end up here somewhere. So you can do the same at 7. So if you eyeball this, typically you gain 1 day in forecast range for the same accuracy in 10 years. So every 10 years we can forecast 1 day better. So that's very nice, of course. But nobody knows how long we can continue to do this, because this is impossible to continue over the next decades. Other reasons why this is increasing is, of course, that we have more capable computers. We can allow more and more resolution into the systems. This will continue over the next decades. And improved weather models. So since we have a lot of observations, we can compare the models with the observations, we can tweak the models to fit the observations, use more observations, etc. So this cycle all makes that this can happen. So sometimes you get new observations. This is a plot that shows the contribution to the reduction of the forecast error of different observing systems. So here you see all different kinds of satellite data, and here you below you see conventional data. So you see indeed that the sum of the bars in the satellite data is much bigger than the sum of the bars in the conventional data. So indeed satellite data are very important for weather forecasting. You see two colors, one is from May 2012, the other one is from May 2013. And this bar only occurs in May 2013, because these are the OceanSat scatterometer data, which we process at KNMI and we give them to ECMUF. They go into the ESPN system and they give this forecast error reduction. And this is in the presence of all the other data. Also the data from the European scatterometer, ASCAT-A, which is over here. So you see that if we add OSCAT to ASCAT-A, you get an additional almost 5% forecast error reduction because of the OceanSat satellite data, which is a very good effect, of course. And you see it does not go at the expense of ASCAT-A because these two bars are always the same length. So you can still add new data and reduce the forecast error. You can also show, this is a plot I got from GMA, Japanese Meteorological Agency. They are using different scatterometer data, QuickSCAT, ASCAT, or combined. And look at the impact on forecast tracks of tropical cyclones. So also these data can be used in numeric weather prediction models to improve the tracks of forecasts. This is now from OceanSat, so from the new Indian satellite data, and there you see the same thing. On top of adding it on top of existing satellite data, again you see there's an improvement in the forecast track. If you look how these data are used at ECMWF, for instance, this is a graph showing how the ERES2 data are used, and you see that near the center of the tropical cyclone, the data are actually thrown away. So these high extreme winds, which we think are very important for tropical cyclone forecasting, are actually thrown away by the ECMWF model. But ECMWF is producing the best forecast intensity and track forecasts that exist. So these accurate forecasts apparently depend on the environment of the hurricane. So how the hurricane is fed with humid air is more important for its evolution than exactly how strong the wind is close to its center. So this is sometimes things work different than you would first expect. So now go to a case in 2007 where we also were closing the Maaslandkering. And we're doing now some experiments for wave and search projects. And we look at different wind fields, and this is coloring the speed. So here you see the forces in the wind. This is ECMWF, and this is where the area we were interested in. You see the ECMWF field is quite smooth, even if it's 16 kilometers, it's not showing mesoscale variability. This is Harmony, our new model, which is a clone from the French Arpège model. And you see it has a lot of small scale variability in the wind fields, which looks much like the cells that I showed before. So it could be quite realistic. This is the verifying data that we have from the QuickSCAT scatterometer. Indeed, it also shows changes in speed, but they seem to be smaller than the changes you see in the model. Then if you try to combine this and that into an estimated field, you see that the estimation step is actually, again, reinforcing the differences. And I would say it's overfitting, actually, so there's something going wrong here. Because our estimation schemes are not capable of dealing with this type of small-scale variations. So we first need to better understand mesoscale data simulation and mesoscale models to be able to use the data at those scales. Okay. Then we have the other problem, which is that you collect observations for numeric weather prediction in analysis windows, which have a certain length. Then you run them after the analysis window is finished, usually. If you are doing short-range forecasting, it could be a short period of only half an hour. And then you cycle this system. So it means that if your data are only delivered within 2 hours, that part of the data will not make it before the cutoff in the estimation window, and you will just throw them away, essentially not use them. Or you will run another backup experiment where you use them 12 hours later or 6 hours later. So you have to think about the duty cycle or the efficiency of your assimilation cycle compared to the delivery time of the of satellite data.
So I did that essentially for all the HeLa member states and see how efficient they are using the data.
And so here you see the cycle time. So 6 hours means four times a day. At KMI, we at that time ran 8 times a day, 3 hours. This is the cutoff time. So in our case, 2 hours, also 2 hours in most of the other member states. The blue cycle, duty cycle, is with a timeliness of observations of 30 minutes. And the red one is with 2 hours. So you see that with a delivery time of 30 minutes, only KNMI with a cycle of 3 hours is able to exploit all data. And then you have to have everything within half an hour. It doesn't happen. If you say, well, I'll allow 2 hours for observations to come in, so data come in over this period, then actually KNMI would use 50% of the data. Now you see also some other cycles, senders are then able to exploit the data at 50% efficiency. This 50% for satellites means that you always get data in one part of your domain and you never get satellite data in another part of your domain, because your cycle actually interferes with the sampling pattern of the satellite. So this is something you have to think about if you want to do data simulation operationally. Not in research mode, because you can use everything, but if you really want to use it, think about it. Yes, of course, as I showed, there is meter-scale variability that has impact on surges and impact on waves and impact on all kinds of other meteorological applications, on everything, I would say. There is a general tendency to go to shorter cycling, because if you do shorter cycling, you're able to use observations faster and give better guidance to the public. So what I just said is only getting more important. Okay, so next graph is about what's called by Greg Tripoli a paradigm change in the coming years. So if you look at horizontal grid distance in the vertical and you look at time in the horizontal, until now we've seen that since we have faster and faster computers, we can reduce the grid spacing of models. And this will probably continue in the years to come, because Moore's law will continue to be applicable. So we will be able to run smaller and smaller scale models. The model grid is not a model resolution. So if you say we have, I don't know, 1 kilometer HeLa data, it's not that you can see things of 1 kilometer, because you have dynamical equations that you have to close, which take, and they implement horizontal diffusion to suppress instabilities. Typically, you need 5 to 7 times a grid distance to get a closure. So model resolution, model resolve wavelength is above grid spacing. But even if you consider this, it means that current global models typically have resolutions of a few hundred kilometers. Yes, this will probably keep going down. Metascale models on limit domain typically have, well, now we made spectra for the Harmony model, the Arpège model at 1 kilometer. It has a spectral content down to 25 kilometers, which is quite unique. So 25 kilometers, quite compatible with the scatterometer. So you can then start using these data in a complete way. But we don't have that many observations that model the evolution of mesoscale dynamical structures in the atmosphere. We will not be able to fill this degrees of freedom that we add to the model. That's not possible. And that's why we develop ensemble techniques to try to physically represent these small scales, but only present them as probability distributions rather than as deterministic forecasts. So deterministic forecasts will probably level off because we have a limited observing system. Then you can also try to look what do we need if we want to follow these meter-scale structures in the atmosphere. Well, if you look at the dynamic equations of the atmosphere. And for instance, you look at 45 north, you can look at the Rossby radius of deformation, which is a scale above which temperature and pressure determine the evolution of the waves. But if waves are shorter scale, then wind is actually determining the evolution of these scales. So that means if you want to understand the atmospheric dynamics, you need to look at the wind for those small scales. So suggests that in terms of horizontal scale, we are now at a few hundred kilometers. In terms of vertical scale, we are maybe at a kilometer. And of course, what we want to do is to go in this corner, smaller horizontal resolution, smaller, shallower vertical scales. So we want to go there. So we will need more and more wind observations to go to that point. Small scales are fast. And large scales are slow. So a low pressure system of a thousand kilometers you can track for a few days on the map. But a mesoscale complex, you can't do that. It only lasts for a few hours and then it's gone. Or gone, it's at least dissipated. So if you want to follow these structures, you need these measurements very often. Not only wind and small spatial detail, but also quite often in time. So a double challenge in a way. So if you look at global scatterometer missions, scatterometers provide the wind vector at the ocean surface. So they actually look at the ocean surface, and from the roughness of the ocean surface, they can determine the wind vector, both the speed and the direction. And that's what I showed on the map. And these are all different scatterometer instruments that will exist in the coming years. So we have, in Europe, we have METOP A and METOP B as polar satellites flying the Earth. They're both flying the Earth, so this time we have a tandem scatterometer system from the METOP A and the METOP B satellite. In 2018 there will be METOP C, so this series will continue in tandem probably. I mentioned the Indian scatterometer data, Ocean Z2. So we receive those data from the Indians, we process them and we distribute them all over the world. Great success, as I showed, impact in the ESBF system and other applications. We also have a Chinese satellite scatterometer, which is Haiyang 2A. And we are trying to work with them to get also those data in the human cell system. But that seems more complicated than with the Indian satellite, although they have a very good example in the Indian system, a very successful one. This seems to go slower. There will be a scatterometer system on the space station, which will be mainly in the tropics and extratropical region around the tropics, a trade region. It will measure winds, so it will cover all the other scatterometers. It will be quite interesting. China has plans to make this operational, and at that time they promise operational data, so that will be good. And also Russia is planning a satellite, so we're also trying to work with them to get operational data. And there's even also some more plans here. There's also a satellite from China and France, the Chinese-French Oceanographic Satellite, which also has a scatterometer and a wave measuring instrument on board that will also complement the data that we have here. So these polar satellites, they are sun synchronous, so they always, they tend to measure at given local times. So this is 9:30 in the morning and 9:30 in the afternoon. You get measurements from this instrument. Ocean set will be 12 o'clock and midnight, so then you will get another round of measurements at our latitudes. And Haiyang 2A is very interesting because it's 6 o'clock in the morning and 6 o'clock in the evening. So if you had all these three satellites, you would have very good coverage over the day. So that's really what we would like to achieve. So this is essentially summarizing what I just said. There's also requirements at WMO level. They actually require 6-hourly ocean surface vector wind data. And there's, of course, many applications that are profiting from this type of coverage, not only search forecasting. So what do you see in scattrometers that you do not see in models? Just some examples that are collected over the years. So again in blue you see the Hiram winds, and in red you see the scattrometer winds, and in gray you see the infrared image. In the infrared image you tend to see some nodes in the clouds field, and at the scattrometer you can see there's clearly a wave, a Rossby wave in the polar front. And this is a case where our forecasts failed because one of these nodes actually developed in a low, and that low crossed to the Netherlands, unfortunately. So we predicted very nice weather, but it was a very wet and windy day. And the UK was the opposite, so they predicted rain because the cold front would be lingering there, but actually the low pressure system crossed to the Netherlands, so they had a nice day. Tropical cyclones, of course, scattrometers measure winds around tropical cyclones. This is a KNMI production of the quickscat winds, which we also now use for OceanSat. It's the same processing, it's the same instrument. This is from the Americans, and the green is here ECMWF, and the red are the scattrometer data. So you see this scattrometer processing throws away a lot of data near the center of the cyclone, and also gets the directions wrong here. So it also matters which products you're using. With NOAA, we worked on calibrating the European scattrometer at extreme winds, and we're going to make a new step because some of the NOAA hurricane data are being recalibrated. And I flew with them through Ike. And when I flew through Ike with the NOAA people in this hurricane, HCAT at that time measured the ever highest winds at that time, which was 75 knots. So that was really hit in terms of experiment. Of course, the problem is that besides scattrometers, there's not much other data you can trust at these very extreme winds. The NOAA hurricane hunters have an airplane that is like your lab. So they fly in the hurricane, they look down with a step frequency microwave radiometer, which is also a remote sensing instrument, but they can calibrate it with drop zones, which they have been dropping for more than 30 years now with the instrument. And then that combination with the flight level data you can use to collocate with the satellite scattrometer data, and this is we think the best way to try to calibrate these scattrometers. Current scattrometers have a problem with reduced sensitivity at extreme winds, and for the next generation scattrometer in Europe we propose the cross-polarization channel to get better quality extreme winds in hurricanes. Then you can do the processing at different resolutions. So this is 12.5 kilometer sampling of a hurricane, and this is what we normally process. You can find on our website and use in real time. This is 6.25, and if you do this, you see some new structures appearing in the wind field, which we of course have to verify. You can also do it at 3 kilometers sampling, and then you get this picture, and again in this picture you see some new structures appearing. So, of course, there's also clearly noise, because we expect noise at those resolutions. But if the gradients are very big, then of course the noise is less important than the signal. And then you can actually, could be able to see something. And in hurricanes, that could be quite useful. Of course, measuring with scattrometers in hurricanes is very important. I mean, National Hurricane Center mentions the ACE-CAT scattrometer data from Europe in 20% of their web discussions, so they're using it a lot for forecasting. And of course, what they have to do is classify the hurricanes. So we need a link between what we see in the scattrometer and how they classify the hurricanes in terms of 1 minute or 10 minute sustained winds. But 1 minute and 10 minutes sustained winds are something quite different from an average measurements of an area of 25 kilometers. is very different. But that's something we have to translate. So as I said, wind vector sizes are typically 50, 25, maybe a bit smaller, but not much. So this means that if you have a cyclone and this is the wind vector size, you will smear out these extreme winds. So the question is how to translate scatterometer winds to hurricane categories. Normally for weather models, meteorologists use guidance, so they know that if the model sees a certain speed, they have an idea of what the gustiness is, and then they can sort of have a prediction of what 1 minute or 10 minutes sustained winds they could typically expect. So this is typically a factor of 1.5 or 2 higher than what you see in the scatterometer data. This is a graph showing spatial representation. So suppose you could put a buoy measurement along a distance axis. You can do that using the so-called Taylor hypothesis, which translates as actually the time axis of a buoy measurement with the mean speed into a spatial axis, so then you can actually do this. So suppose you had this blue buoy measurement measuring locally the wind. And then you had a scatterometer, like ASCAT, which can see 25 kilometer areas. If you convolve this 25 kilometer footprint over this distance axis, you get the green line. So you see the green line is more smooth than the blue line, of course. If you go to the ECMWF model, which has a typical footprint of a few hundred kilometers, then again you get something which is again smoother, like the red line. So that will be your depiction of the blue line in terms of what you keep. So in scatterometers we evaluate area mean wind vectors with empirical geophysical model functions. And be aware that 25 kilometer aerial winds are less extreme than 10 minute sustained winds. So that means also that extreme buoy winds should be higher than extreme scatterometer winds, yes? If you only look at the tops, the highest wind you can find, you find that the blue high wind is always higher than the green highest wind. So in forecasting, you have to be aware of this. And also the same is true for the models, of course. You cannot expect a model to give you extreme hurricane force winds, generally. Okay, so I told you about the tandem scatterometer data. This is actually a measurement of the tandem data. Again, in the background you see infrared image. So here you see a cloud pack, and over there. Here you see the time. You can also see them, those times on our website at KLMI. So the red times correspond to the red arrows, and the blue time corresponds to the blue arrows. You see there's a 50-minute difference between blue and red time, which is always the case because the satellites chase each other at 50 minutes difference in the same orbit. One orbit lasts 100 minutes, so it means either the A is in front of B by 50 minutes or B is in front by A 50 minutes. It's the same thing. So the time difference is always 50 minutes. So here you see what is changing in 50 minutes. And where you see this big cloud pack, you see that in the blue arrows, the winds are clearly different than in the red arrows. So this is because wind is coming down, falling on the sea, and then spreading out. And this is called the downbursts. So you see these convective downbursts in the tropics quite obviously in the data. So this is when the wind field actually changes substantially within. Yes. This is looking into tropical systems, and this plot is a little bit more complicated, but let me explain it. You see the arrows now in blue, they're quite small, but this is actually the winds that the scatterometer sees on the ocean. And again, you see some areas where there's a lot of wind variability. Then you see the black contours. The black contours is a rain radar in space that measures the rain rate. So this is where you are sure that there is rain falling, and there will be downbursts at some point. So in those places you indeed see that the winds at the surface are also disturbed. So that is logical. What I didn't say is that scatterometers, or the ASCAT scatterometer at least, we know that for sure because that's what we've looked at most, has also a parameter that we retrieve in the wind retrieval. That's a residual. And that residual appears to be related to the wind variability in a 25 kilometer area. So you actually see the gustiness in a 25 kilometer area. So you expect gustiness to be high, of course, in areas where it's raining, and low, like around zero, or negative, in areas where it's not raining. And that's what you exactly see in all those images. So we see the gustiness in the satellite data, which is something great to be exploited, but we didn't do so far. But we, for instance, we have also problems with, or we have still some issues in the processing for these small scale systems, because we get ambiguities in the wind direction. And if we know where winds are changing and variable, we can actually use that information to get a better processing. But not only for the processing. I will show the next slide, where I use the same scale of wind variability as here. So the unit is arbitrary, but if it's negative, it means green, yellow, and gray. It means it's very stable, so less than usual, less than nominal wind variability. If it's purple, red, or black, it means more than usual wind variability. So if you do, then look at the next plots. You see here a lot of red along this S-shaped line. And it means that would suggest there's a lot of wind variability along this line. Then you see the scatterometer wind solutions. Everything we think is plausible given the state of the roughness state of the ocean. And these are these black arrows. And you see every point has two arrows pointing in opposite directions. That's because the roughness of the ocean cannot tell us whether the wind is blowing towards us or away from us. So we have this basic ambiguity. Yes? But you can follow the streamlines. Yes, I put latitude, minus 25, 156 is the latitude position, so this is the southern hemisphere. Southern hemisphere, bad weather, low pressure system, you expect winds to blow like this around the low pressure system, yes? So if I follow streamlines, I would say, well, this is where the wind is going. So I don't need any ambiguity removal, I can do it by myself, just looking at this single image. This is the ECVF winds plus the MLE for the same time and the same location. ECVF has a low here and has winds in a circular pattern blowing around it. So this pattern is certainly more complicated than this one. And this one is observed and this one is modeled. This is ASCAT solutions plus speed. So here you see the color is the speed. Again, you see this high wind area and this high wind area, which follows these streamlines and these streamlines, with lower winds where the S-shape is. And that's where the wind variability is. These are the solution of our processor of this case. And indeed, it has these easterly, southeasterly winds feeding into this system. It has this circulation around it feeding into this branch of this S shape. It all seems right. But here it has winds from the north blowing to the south, below this area of high wind variability. So that's clearly wrong. So it selected the wrong ambiguity. Because now it suggests that there's a front here with winds of 15 meters per second from the south on one side, winds from 15 meters per second on the other side, and no area of enhanced wind variability in between. That's totally implausible. Cannot exist in reality. So these winds are wrong and should blow from the south. And then this S shape is actually the frontal area of the system. It's a convective system. You can see this with only looking at the SCAT data. And actually what we do is we use the ECF winds as a first indication of the wind direction of the scatterometer solutions, and then we look at spatial consistency. In this case, we have taken these winds because ECMF has these winds, and our automatic scheme has not been capable of turning them back in the right direction, which is of course a danger if we have mesoscale features in the scatterometer data and not in the ECMF model. Then occasionally we can run into this type of problem. But we can save ourselves by looking at the wind variability measure in the data. And that's something we will be working on. But it looks like a pretty complete set of wind data on the ocean surface, and much more details than you will get from a model. And of course, in terms of a search, this would make a hell of a difference. I don't have to explain to you, I guess, whether you use ECMF or the scatterometer. Well, we did a lot of validation work on the scatterometer data, and they generally appear to be quite good on the scale of the scatterometer, well below a meter per second. So if you do this trip collocation, so all these numbers are for the exactly the same weather, but they are at the 25 kilometer scale. And you see that buoy data, if you look on a 25 kilometer scale, typically have an error of 1.2 meter per second. That's not because the buoys are bad, but it's because there's a lot of wind variability in a cell of 25 kilometers, which is exactly 1.2 meter per second. So that's what you see here. This is how the buoy compares to the scatterometer. And this is how ECMF compares to the scatterometer. You see ECMF has typically errors of around 1.5 meter per second if you compare it to the scale of a scatterometer. So again, it's much cruder than the ASCAT data. Okay. Something about OceanSat. Different groups have been processing data from the Indian satellite. So ISRO is from India, the Indian Space Research Organization, NOAA and NASA and JPL. And there's some independent verification by Nato Ibuchi from the Tokai University in Japan. And well, we have a very favorable comparison at KNMI. What we did at KNMI is essentially use the same processing for QuickSCAT and OceanSat, because they're essentially the same instruments. We just calibrate the input sigma knots. And that seems to work very well. Also for the wind direction. Yeah, this is on the Chinese satellite, Haiyang 2A. And also for Haiyang 2A, we are already with some very small corrections. And only 1 week of data, we were able to get very good comparisons. So if we get the data, we're already sure that it will be quite good data. Yeah, this is just to say that the users of the scatterometer data are actually from many different applications and from many different organizations everywhere in the world. And this is just giving you some idea of the data. If you want to know more about the scatterometer winds and hear about wind and wave training on scatterometer winds, then here's some links that you can find, where you find both PowerPoint presentations and also video presentations on the scatterometer winds. You also find this information on our website under training. Okay. So we're working on a requirement to get scatterometer winds every 6 hours with a virtual constellation of scatterometers that we want to collaborate in an international way and put all those resources together for the public good. We already were quite successful with India. They gave us a lot of help in making these data operational on the globe. And now we are working with China to do the same thing. There's also some other sensors that will come that will give some more wind data. For instance, there's now some L-band systems that will provide extreme winds in particular, as well as we have a Sentinel mission which have SAR winds that will become operational, also complementing the system that we have. So the needs that we have for winds are really near real time. I think I've stressed that sufficiently. Coastal is also a very key in providing winds extremes is a key, and mesoscale is a key. And this is not only true for surges, it's also true for waves and for other applications like wind energy, etc. So, okay.